Okay, what I'm going to focus on is Africa's, China's activities in Africa, and in some ways the global implications, but mainly those for places like Australia. As you know, the Australian dollar and much of our economy is based on exports to China. I think that the federal political arena has missed the boat. I mean, Tweedledee, Tweedledum in Australian politics. The time when they could have taxed the mining industry to pay for the type of infrastructure and development you need for the post-boom are rapidly drawing to a close. Is the mining boom over? I'm afraid it is not, maybe at the moment, but it's coming, all right? And the politicians know that. One of the things that frustrates me is the way in which politics in this country, they seem to be unwilling to tell Australians real home truths. Better we just squabble over incidentals. If you look at it, the federal government actually sort of funded a piece of research that was produced in April predicting the fall in the price of iron ore. Well, 3 months ago, iron ore in Australia was $180 a ton. It's now down on, well, it's bounced back up above 90, but it's still around $90 a ton. And that means people like Fortescue are in deep trouble. On the other hand, Africa, the basket case, is going through an economic boom. Don't take it from me. You know, I'll show you a bunch of things from Ernst & Young and Standard Bank of South Africa. They're forecasting major investments. It's been growing. The economy of almost every one of the 54 countries of Africa have been experiencing an economic boom. In part, it's because they weren't really exposed to the economic downturn because sub-Saharan Africa was virtually locked out of the capital market anyway. So when everything went belly up on the general financial crisis, it didn't have much of an impact. And the other thing that's happened is the external debt of sub-Saharan Africa has fallen at a time when there's been increasing foreign direct investment. The other thing is that what we sometimes forget is Africa has a growing middle class. A growing middle class with a disposable income. And disposable income is something over $5,000, and therefore you have some money to spend. The other thing about sub-Saharan Africa is it's 60% of the world's uncultivated arable lands. But more important is minerals. By the way, I've left out iron and coal. They're so ubiquitous, there's no use bothering with that. Let's look at the real sort of mineral wealth of Africa. And you look down that list, and you can see that if you're a miner, this is the place to go. By the way, I'll get back to rare earths later on in the lecture, but 50% of the known mineral bodies that rare earths are derived from can be found in Africa. And then there's natural gas and petroleum. By the way, since I downloaded this graph, they found natural gas off the coast of Tanzania, Mozambique. They are found oil in Lake Albert in Uganda. There are deposits of oil and natural gas in northern Kenya. the offshore natural gas deposits in Kenya have been somewhat disappointing. There's even, by the way, gas in petroleum fields in Puntland in northern Somalia. So that, you know, a lot of things are happening. Liberia, Sierra Leone. And China is moving fast. If you look at China's trade with sub-Saharan Africa, it pipped the Brits, and then it took second place from the French in 2006, and then in 2009, China became sub-Saharan Africa's major trading partner, outdoing the Americans, right? Bloomberg's are predicting that by 2015, you're talking about a trade, something like $300 billion, right? So we're talking about big bucks. And what's it in? Well, imports from Africa into China are mainly minerals, right? And that includes oil. In terms of China's imports, there you can see a better graph, and you can see how mineral and that includes oil has grown enormously. In terms of China's exports to Africa, it's manufacturing electricals, right? And you can see it cuts across a wide range of countries. It's led to mounting paranoia in the Western media. I single out the Murdoch media because I'm an American, and if you go to America, you're hard-pressed to find anything but the Murdoch media, all right? And in some ways, they've driven American response to the expansion of China and American paranoia. I sympathize with President Obama. I think he's been pushed to a certain position with China, because there's an election coming up and he doesn't dare seem to be soft. There's also accusations that, you know, China is supporting corrupt governments. I'll get onto that in a second. China's aid to Africa is self-interested. The IMF World Bank has constantly used this term, rogue creditor. By the way, they've done it while themselves demanding repayment of loans from corrupt African governments, that have a historic. And there's finally the myth of some kind of grand strategy on the part of China, right? Now I'm gonna deal with each one of these in turn. Impact of Chinese imports into Africa, it's one of the things that certain Western governments have raised. Look at the de-skilling, the deindustrialization of Africa was caused by the World Bank and the IMF. Whereas in independence and even into the 70s, Africa had levels of local domestic industry. These were systematically, in my view, undermined by the policies of the World Bank, the IMF, that they should focus on basic commodity exports and not try to compete with cheaper imports from, in those days, the West, basically from America, Europe. If you look at Chinese imports, yes, they have undercut and reduced the price of goods in and I'd give a few examples. But I would state that those goods aren't produced in Africa anyway, and from an African point of view, cheap Chinese imports are a bit like cheap Chinese imports here. They're what the customer wants. In terms of loans and tied loans, in fact, China has very few restrictions on and few strings to its loan policies. The one major one is the one China policy. You know, you can't trade, you can't be both trading with the Taiwanese, recognize Taiwan, and recognize mainland China, right? The other thing about China is it's got a long history, and it's a long history, of debt forgiveness to governments that have basically supported China diplomatically. And have formed closer economic ties. And in terms of Africa's overall debt, China is not a major player. We constantly hear about free trade, and I'll talk about it in this lecture and the complaints that have been made by Western business. I would point out that it's the US and the EU who have been instrumental in creating problems for the vast majority of African countries where most of the population are peasant farmers. If you look at Burkina Faso, its major export is cotton. And yet Burkina Faso can't begin to compete with the Americans because of the subsidies that go on to American textiles. There's the world price, there's the American textiles with the subsidy. See, they couldn't even sell the stuff abroad anyway without it, because the farmers get too much. And there's Burkina Faso. Well, Burkina Faso can't sell because that's being dumped. And you could go on and on about this. The Japanese, the Europeans, they all support, and the Australians support their farmers. U.S. subsidies to the cotton growers and textile industry was really only partially offset by a thing that was called the African Growth and Opportunity Act that was meant to help African third world countries export more to the United States. There's accusations that they're right. I mean, the Chinese do deals with countries like Mugabe, Zimbabwe. In 2007, Sino-Steel did a deal to acquire a large stake in the non-ferrous, non-iron mines in Zimbabwe. The Chinese in Zimbabwe are in joint ventures on some very dubious diamond mining projects, right? And it's true. But then again, let's look at the West. I mean, you know, Robert Mugabe was the freedom fighter turned corrupt, and there was all kinds of Western business deals done with Robert Mugabe when they knew what was happening. When the massacre of Zapu took place in Bulawayo after independence, Western governments knew about it. This is before Robert Mugabe was regarded as a baddie, but they knew about the massacre. Thousands of Mugabe's, Joshua Nkomo's supporters were massacred. And yet, it was business as usual. President Bongo of Gabon, I mean, you know, a really corrupt guy, ran Gabon as if it was a private fief. And yet, you know, there was all kinds. And you could go around, my favorite is, of course, Colonel Mobutu, helped to be installed by the CIA and was there for decades, pillaging Zaire, what later became the Democratic Republic of Congo, in conjunction with French and American mining interests, and Belgian mining interests. In terms of tied aid, you know, American tied aid is very high. By the way, Australian tied aid is very high, largely because of PNG, where most of the aid that goes to PNG ends up in the hands of a handful of Australian companies. But, you know, if you look at things like the China Export-Import Bank, and you look at sort of a recent loan they did to Angola, $12 billion at 1.5% interest with a five-year non-payment period. That's a pretty good deal for Angola. Hey, the only sort of initial clause was that the first $2 billion of that $12 billion went through a Chinese companies, and I'll explain to you how the model works in a second. American companies complain about Chinese, and Australian companies complain about Chinese support for state-owned enterprises, right? As if it's something peculiar to China. It is not. IMF argues that China undercuts IMF economic policies. Yes, it does. I love this comment, though, by the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, right? Be wary of donors who are more interested in extracting your resources than building your capacity. I wonder if she said that tongue-in-cheek. If you look at the Export-Import Bank of China, it actually provided more money to sub-Saharan Africa than the World Bank. Just think about that. The Chinese Development Bank has given sort of special loans mainly to small and medium-sized enterprises. You're not talking about, you know, the Chinese Development Bank doesn't do the big dams and mines and all those other stuff as the smaller stuff, all right? So it's got a good track record. Chinese investment strategies, long term, they're based on national security and not on short term commercial profit. That's why Western companies have trouble with Chinese state-owned enterprises. Albeit, the main policy body, the National Development and Reform Commission, is increasingly taking a tougher stance on Chinese foreign direct investments by Chinese quangos and state-owned enterprises. It's mainly because they did some really poor investments in WA, and they weren't backed by proper risk assessments, right? They took the Australians at their word and got stung. The other thing, China is becoming increasingly sensitive to hostility towards Chinese investment, basically in the United States and Australia. They're already sort of becoming worried about that, and this country ought to worry about it because the Chinese cut off their investments, and this country is dependent upon foreign direct investments. It doesn't raise enough capital domestically to deal with its problems. We could be in trouble there. In terms of the way it's organized, you have the Chinese Ministry of Finance, the Chinese Investment Corporation, and then two major banks. And they filter through to state-owned enterprises. The big banks are, of course, the Export-Import Bank, which is one of the largest credit agencies in the world. You have the Chinese Development Bank, and it supports a whole range of investments in agriculture, manufacturing, infrastructure. You can read it, resources. And then there's the Chinese Agricultural Bank, but it mainly deals with internal agricultural developments in China. So that development bank really doesn't count so much. In terms of the Export-Import Bank, to give you an idea of scale, in 2008, the Chinese Export-Import Bank actually provided more credit than the rest of the G7. So what we're talking about is you know. And in terms of investments, I give you the example of the China in Angola. The Chinese provided loan material to rebuild the Benguela Railway that had been destroyed by rebels during the Angolan Civil War, right? And it wasn't a direct quid pro quo, but Son Angola, which is the company that deals with all oil sort of contracts in Angola, when Shell wanted to sell off part of its block to the Indians, it wasn't approved. And later on, that block was allocated to China, for the Chinese Petroleum and Chemical Corporation. Similarly, when Total didn't sort of fully develop one of its sites, it was taken away from Total, the license, and it wasn't renewed and given to a Chinese company. Angola has now surpassed Saudi Arabia as the major supplier of oil to China. Here's the Chinese model. The Chinese government provides loans, right? It signs an agreement with a foreign government. This is sometimes called the Angolan model. It then awards contracts directly to Chinese companies, rather than through the government of Angola. And it therefore controls what's going to happen. When the Chinese go in to invest and to build something, they make sure it's built. It's built on time, on budget, and works. In return, the government repays, but in commodities. In the case of Angola, oil at world spot price. It isn't asking for a special price, it's saying we'll get it, but it goes through the Chinese oil company, and that guarantees the supply of oil to China. In terms of Chinese overseas investment, here you can see sub-Saharan Africa. You can compare it with Australia, all right? It's actually larger than Australia's, and it's growing, all right? By the way, U.S. investment is coming down. It was mainly government bonds and real estate. Now they've decided that the dollar is sort of taking such a hammering, that U.S. dollar, that if the Americans don't begin to show some fiscal responsibility, China's going to stop buying. Some examples of Chinese investment. In 2006, China outbid Brazil for the Belinga iron ore mine. I'll come back to this in a second. It's amongst the world's richest iron ore. We think of the newspapers here keep talking about iron ore prices dropping, because China is reducing its demand. That the demand, it's a question of demand factor, right? Whereas what they've overlooked is the fact that China has built up other supplies. Australia is just one of the suppliers, and now they are sourcing elsewhere. In terms of China's demand for iron ore and steel, might I suggest that China is now talking about developing a blue water navy? My heavens, you can put an awful lot of steel into a blue water navy and not even notice it. So I don't know, it's China is slacking off just because they're not building buildings and using reinforcing steel that way. The other thing that China did, for example, is it acquired a big stake in Standard Bank of South Africa. Standard Bank of South Africa has branches all over Southern Africa, and it allows China to have access through its holdings in Standard Bank. You know, there is China's third largest steel producer, and it's exploring in Madagascar. And it's, you know, you could go on. The Chinese have been doing joint ventures and buying into iron mines all over Africa, not just South Africa. Sometimes they have overstretched. One of the troubles China is having at the moment and has had for the last 18 months is basically their acquisitions have outstripped management capability, right? One of the problems they have is human resources, not money. So, for example, in Belinga, the mine in Gabon, they acquired it in 2006. It almost went to BHP earlier this year. BHP was prepared to cut a deal with the new president of Gabon. The only reason, as far as I can see, it fell through was BHP decided to pull back, as it has in a lot of areas, right? In Australia and elsewhere. It was part of its retrenchment in the Pilbara and Olympic Dam, other ways. But, I mean, as I say, the Chinese almost came unstuck because they hadn't moved fast enough. To give you an example of Chinese development in Africa, they went into the DRC. Gave the Export-Import Bank of China gave $8.5 billion to the government of the DRC in exchange for iron ore and copper. It was to be administered through a Chinese DRC joint venture. What was interesting about it was, unlike many of the projects that the Chinese get involved in Africa, only 20% of the workforce was Chinese, and they promised to do a lot of local contracting. In return, the Chinese agreed to do all kinds of infrastructural development, all right? What happened was that there was a huge backlash, particularly by the Americans, about, you know, sort of Chinese undermining free market capitalism, all right? I would point out that in 2005, an American company did a deal in DRC on much less favorable terms, all right? And it was well backed by the American government, European Investment Bank, and others. And by the way, IMF also got involved in the DRC deal. I don't regard the IMF as a neutral body, by the way. I think it has too long been a stalking horse for Western commercial interests in ways that have disadvantaged third world countries. It threatened, in this case, to actually withdraw DRC's debt forgiveness program if it didn't renegotiate the deal with China. China and oil in Africa, There are three major Chinese development companies in the oil industry. China is a Johnny-come-lately to the African oil industry, but is growing fast. Take, for example, Sudan. There is the Chinese holdings up at the top. And you can see the big ones are basically China, Petronas, which is Malaysian, and the Indian Offshore Natural Gas Corporation, right? But all kinds of companies are in Sudan. Sudan recently split up, and we'll talk about this in a second. The South broke away, and a lot of the best oil fields are in the South. But anyway, before Sudan divided, the Sudanese government did a deal with the Chinese to build a pipeline. The trouble is the oil fields are all down in the south here, and you got to get the oil to the Port Sudan. They built a 1,600 kilometer pipeline in 18 months. Now that's quite a feat. And as a result, China's consumption of Sudanese oil skyrocketed. Sudan went from being a supplier of less than 1% of Chinese imports to within 2 years being almost 10%. By the way, the Chinese didn't discover the oil in Sudan. Chevron of the United States did. And there's a long political history there. And it brings me to the politics that's going on between China and the United States. When they discovered oil in Sudan, the American government had no qualms about providing the Namira dictatorship with arms. In fact, at one stage, Sudan was the sixth largest recipient of US arms aid. Then there was a coup by the current dictator of, and he's been there a while, 89. We're now in 2012. Omar al-Bashir came in with the support of the National Islamic Front, and that created all kinds of domestic political problems for America. And there was tension between America and the Sudan. Chevron ended up selling its interest in Sudan. By the way, it did it at the behest of the US government. Chevron didn't really want to sell, but was more or less strong-armed into it. What the American didn't realize is that when Chevron sold to the Pakistanis were going to sell on to the Chinese and the Indians. It was a Canadian company, but it was actually owned by a Pakistani family. By the way, the US has been long fighting a long quiet secret war in the Sudan against the Sudanese government, right? It's not excusing what happened in Darfur and what's happened in the southern Sudan, but it's been going on for a very long time, and the Americans actually have been supplying the rebels with arms and equipment, right? Basically military aid funneled through Ethiopia and Kenya. And it's all about increasing American paranoia about China and its resource grab in Africa. By the way, there's this, I won't go into it all, but when in 2011, the southern Sudan became an independent country, and suddenly Khartoum found that most of its revenue was drying up, and the government in Khartoum was based on a patronage system of bribery to keep Omar al-Bashir in power, and his milk cow was drying up. So he suddenly decided they would increase the transport cost of oil from the southern Sudan along that pipeline to $38 a barrel. rather well in excess of world prices, right? By the way, they struck a deal this month in Addis. I don't know it's going to last, but the southern Sudanese have agreed to pay the Khartoum a higher price, not the $38 they were asking, and not the 69 cents they offered, but in between. But in the meantime, they're building a pipeline across Kenya to the port of Lamu. That pipeline is still up for grabs. The Japanese have done a feasibility study, but nobody's come up with really all the money yet, and it's going to be interesting what the Chinese do. Mm. China was actively involved in the oil industry in Kenya. It recently dissolved, it got rid of most of its offshore licenses and moved to Uganda. By the way, there's been major offshore natural gas finds in Tanzania and Mozambique to the south. But an awful lot of companies, including Woodside, have lost millions trying to find natural gas off of Kenya. Tallow has found gas in this part, and the pipeline will go through there, and they'll be able to tap into it. In Uganda, the Tallow sold off part of its exploration areas in Lake Albert to the Chinese Offshore Oil Corporation, right? So the Chinese are active all over the place, right? The other thing that one doesn't hear about very often, I haven't seen much in this country, is AFRICOM. It's one of the 9 U.S. Department of Defense strategic commands, specifically in Africa, specifically to try to protect American so-called strategic interests, right? AFRICOM actually helps Uganda fight against the Lord's Resistance Army, and I'm not saying it was deliberate, but Uganda did delay Tallow's sale to the Chinese National Offshore Oil Company for over 2 years. Other strategic minerals, strategic elements, rare earths. I mentioned it earlier. China became the major supplier of rare earths to the world, and they're important for, among other things, advanced U.S. military technology. By the way, the Americans used to produce it, and they are going back to opening Mountain Pass mine in Colorado. Mountain Pass was closed down because of environmental and health and safety factors, and now the Americans are angry because the Chinese have cut down their export quotas on the same basis. What I'm suggesting to you is that America and China are in tension over all kinds of resources across Africa. And it's because the EU and Americans are so dependent on African oil for alone. In terms of long-term investment, take Ghana, for example. Tallow found an oil field in this part of offshore Ghana. They have now found the Kita field that's supposed to be even bigger, and China has gone in and developing with the Ghanaian National Gas Corporation a joint venture to exploit that. They're providing $1 billion in aid and more to come. But it's not the beginning. This is 2012. Hey, they've been in there since independence in Ghana. But China has been willing to do a whole string of in infrastructure investments and loans to Ghana over the years. For example, they built the Accra-Kumasi Road, and on an interest-free loan, and then when it was all over, they just forgave the whole lot. You know, the Chinese ECOWAS business forum held in Accra earlier this year, it pulled together countries from all over West Africa. Why West Africa? Well, they found oil off of Sierra Leone and Liberia, right? It's not the Americans found it, the British found it, but as the Minister for Oil in Liberia said, it's time we look beyond our traditional trading partners and look towards, he mentioned the BRICS countries, right? Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. They are the new players on the ball field. In terms of symbolism, there's a new AU headquarters in Addis Ababa, built and financed by the Chinese. In an earlier day, this would have been an American, a British, a European project, right? BRICS. It brings together some of the most powerful countries in the world, the up-and-coming ones, right? 30% of the new foreign direct investment in Africa comes from BRICS countries. To give you an example, Mozambique is currently negotiating a loan with China for a deep water port in northern Mozambique, not so much for the offshore gas that they found, and will it be used, but because Brazil is developing a major iron ore mine in northern Mozambique. Okay? But as I say, the Chinese have been in there for years, all right? And is the ultimate prize, the natural gas reserves. BRICS Bank, there's talk of setting up a bank to rival the World Bank, funded by China and other members of BRICS, right? What they're demanding, the BRICS banks in BRICS in Mexico earlier this year, chipped in $75 billion to the IMF, but it suggested to the IMF and World Bank that we need governance reform and voter reform. In other words, more power. And they're also beginning to demand that the World Bank and IMF put greater scrutiny on the lax monetary policies of the EU and the United States. Part of this is all helping to elevate the yuan, the Chinese currency, to an international currency of exchange. In terms of BRICS, the Russian minister, head of the Russian Development Bank, has proposed that BRICS do a currency swap. At the moment, China and Russia do a currency swap that, in terms of China importing oil from Russia, right? It's a major supplier. What they're suggesting now is they set up a bank. What it would allow, for example, the Indians to do is offer cheap loans to Indian business to set up businesses in China funded by the Chinese Export-Import Bank. In terms of the predictions, it said that by 2020, China GDP will exceed that of the United States, India will exceed Japan, Russia will beat Germany, and Brazil will top the UK and France. We are in a changing world, and I'll leave you with that.